Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility on this absolutely gorgeous Tuesday. It is the fifth day of January in the year 2016. It is a pleasure to be with you today. We are fortunate to have Agnes at the controls today. Bob is elsewhere. And so I want to thank Agnes for getting us on the air for our second program this week. And hopefully, all things considered, we should be ready to go tomorrow as well. It is a pleasure to be with you here at the Virtual Center. As you obviously realize, today is Tuesday, and that means that our program begins 30 minutes later than it does on Mondays and Wednesdays. So our program today will be 90 minutes, and it appears that we'll be able to do the full 90 minutes without our regular five-minute break. That recoups a little bit of the time that is lost. I just came from a Rotary meeting, and I'll share with you because it's right on my mind. I just left there. We had kind of a record crowd today. We usually have somewhere around 35, 40, 45 Rotarians at these regular weekly luncheon meetings on Tuesdays. And the programs have been stellar. The programs have been just terrific. We have a wonderful program chairman who's done a great job. But today the speaker was the mayor of Beckley, and he was giving his State of the City address. And today we had about 75 to 80 people turn out for Rotary. So it was running very, very late. And of course, it was a little bit difficult for our hosts, which is at the local Armory Convention Center here, because obviously they weren't preparing for a crowd like that. So consequently, they had to do some scurrying around in order to feed everybody, but they were able to do it. The address was, of course, very positive, because the biggest thing that's happening to our city is that West Virginia University is opening a branch here this fall. And while it will open and begin slowly, the full thrust of West Virginia University's presence in southern West Virginia won't be felt until next year, when West Virginia University Institute of Technology will move its entire operations from Montgomery, which is about 35 miles north of here. They'll be moving their entire operation here to the Beckley area, and they'll be open for business in fall of 2017, which will be a year from this fall. So there's a lot of excitement, a lot of enthusiasm, and a lot of optimism in the area, thinking that with the branch of West Virginia University opening locally here, it's going to stimulate the economy. It's going to stimulate activity. It's going to bring young people into the downtown area. And so there's a lot of anticipation and a lot of excitement here. And it was reflected in today's meeting. It was a very, very positive meeting. And needless to say, the mayor's report on the state of the city was very positive as well. He happens to be a terrific mayor. We're very, very fortunate to have him. He's a longtime resident here. He grew up here. He went to high school here. And I guess either he's fortunate or I'm fortunate, but we share the same name. And so consequently, for several years, we've been exchanging mail. He gets my mail. I get his. The only thing that's saving us from having to do that more often than necessary, than we should, is the fact that both he and I have been in the same place for a number of years. But in the first 5 or 6 years that I was here, it seemed like I was running up to his office, his business office, every couple of days with mail. And when I got there, he usually handed me a bunch of my mail. And that went on for 4 or 5 years, but it's pretty well let up. It's pretty well let up now. We've had a difficult time because we share the same name, first name as well as last name, spelling exactly the same. Not only that, but our middle initials are the same. It's not the same name. His middle name is Andrew. My middle name is Arthur. But when we use William A., it could be either one of us. So that's been a little bit of an issue in town as well. But he's a good, good friend. He's done a wonderful job as mayor. I have not heard one negative comment in the 2 years that he stepped in as mayor. Our longtime mayor, who had been mayor for more than 20 years, left a couple of years ago, and Bill applied for the position and took over control of the city just 2 years ago, 2 years and 3 days ago. It was the New Year's Day 2 years ago. And he has 6 months more to serve, and then a new mayor. We'll have an election in May, and a new mayor will be sworn in July, after July 1st. So he's done a wonderful job. The situation of the condition of the city is good, and it's always good to leave a meeting with a very, very positive feeling, and that's the way today's meeting was. So, I, you know, if I appear to be a little bit up today, it's because I am. The weather is good. The sunshine is coming in the window. It's brisk. It's chilly. It's about 16 degrees here, but with little wind and sun shining, it's just an absolutely gorgeous, invigorating day. I hope that your day is going as well as mine. Obviously, mine's going pretty well. I find that this has been a great day so far. I met a friend and broke bread with him for breakfast, and we spent a couple of hours talking and chatting this morning. And then I came home and cleaned up and went to Rotary and met more friends. And so it's been a very good day for me so far. And I trust that. That positive spirit, as it will be reflected in today's program. I'm looking forward to what I hope will be an enlightening and worthwhile program for you. And I want to thank all of you for your continued support of the Virtual Center and your ongoing support for the Head On Radio Network. We've talked numerous times about how important that support is. I won't go into it again because we just did it, I believe, yesterday. But I want to thank you for your support of the Virtual Center. We're moving rapidly towards, we've now been on for 2 years and 10 months. We're moving rapidly towards our anniversary date of March 11th, which was our first broadcast. And that'll be 3 years. It's hard to believe that we've been on that long. In fact, I've talked to a number of friends, and they're a little bit amazed that we've been able to be on the air 3 days a week, 6 hours a week live, and able to spend that much time on the founding, that much time on the founders. But of course, when you begin to look at the ramifications of the Constitution and how it affects our day-to-day lives today, and you look at the role of the Supreme Court and major Supreme Court interpretations and decisions and opinions, dissenting as well as assenting or concurring opinions, you begin to realize this is an awful lot of information. It's more information than I had really thought about when I first thought about and began to take on the Virtual Center. The more I've gotten into it, the more I've learned. I continue to learn, and I want to thank you, the listening audience, for that. You stimulate me, you excite me, you challenge me, and I thank you for it. And I just hope that I'm able to pay your support and your loyalty back with as many good programs as we're capable of doing. We would love to hear from you. We have a phone number. Our phone number is area code 304-663-4676. That's 304-663-4676. And as you know, 4676 on your keypad translates into horn, H-O-R-N. So it might be easy to remember that way, 304-663-HORN. And Agnes is in the studio, and she will get you on the air if you choose to call. We would love to hear from you. I say that every day. I mean it every day. And I don't want anybody to feel intimidated or feel that the timing is not right. You're going to wait until later and risk losing the point that initially spurred you to think about making a call. If the inclination moves you, then by all means, I encourage you to pick up the phone, get on the air right away, and don't let the opportunity pass. I assure you, I promise you, that not only will I, but other members of our listening audience will appreciate hearing from you as well. We know going in that what you would contribute to our program would be a benefit and be an asset and would contribute to our overall understanding of the issues. I want you to know that, and I want you to know that you are welcome whenever, you choose to call, we invite you to do that. If, on the other hand, you're reluctant to get on the air, and I know a lot of people are for various reasons, then by all means, feel free to drop me an email and share your thoughts or your questions, your ideas, your concerns, whatever they might be, in an email. I promise, I commit to you that I will respond and at least acknowledge your email, and hopefully, depending on what's in it, I can respond in kind. I say that advisedly because I received an email yesterday from one of our listeners, Roger, and it was on an issue that I really didn't have much more to say than the particular link that he directed me to. He was raising some questions and some issues associated with a particular link, and I went to that site, I read the piece, and very honestly, I thanked him for it. I shared with him and acknowledged his interest in that particular issue, but I told him that other than what was in the on the link, I really didn't have a whole lot to add to it. And so, but I did appreciate it, and I continue to appreciate it. Roger's one of our more faithful listeners, and he regularly sends me links and issues. He and Gene and a couple of other people kind of keep me going, and I do appreciate that so much. And finally, I want to mention our Facebook page. It's about 4 months now that we've been on Facebook. We continue to get additional people on Facebook who have indicated that they appreciate some of the things that we that I'm posting on our Facebook page, which was really the intent of starting the page in the first place. And I'm trusting, I hope, that a number of these people are tuning into our programs. At least I invite them every time I put something on Facebook. I try to close it by inviting them to share with us our time together here at the Virtual Center. I give them the broadcast times. I give them the email address, which is headonradionetwork.com, the broadcast address. And I encourage them to join us in our presentations. And I hope, that we've been able to increase our listenership at least a little bit, as a result of the Facebook page. I get some real reactions. In fact, today at the Rotary meeting that I mentioned earlier, three or four different people came up and made specific references to the Facebook posting I did on New Year's. You'll recall from yesterday's program, if you were tuned in, that I went over that posting yesterday, and it contained a stanza from a poem by Louise Driscoll. It was about keeping a little bit magic in our lives, reserving a little bit of space where we could always continue to make believe and continue to dream. And that was really the essence of the message that I put on there. And a number of folks came up at the Rotary meeting today and thanked me for that. And I got a number of likes, in the teens. I think it was something like 16 or 18 or 20 or something like that. And I really appreciated that. So, again, I do invite you to go to our Facebook page. If you go to Facebook, just type in the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution, and you will see a number of postings that I put there, including the one that I just mentioned. Also, the one that we spent quite a bit of time on in yesterday's program, in our first hour, if you'll recall, which dealt with the current campaign for president, for the nomination for president. Most specifically, it dealt with the Republican candidates, primarily the number of candidates that remain alive on the Republican side of the ledger. And my thesis, very quickly, this is in the context of review of yesterday's program, at least the first half of our program yesterday. My general consensus or conclusion is that it's the number of candidates that remain alive on the presidential side, the Republican side of the ledger, more than anything else that is responsible for Donald Trump's ability to hold on to his lead in the polls. That so long as there are that many candidates in the race by definition continues to be personality driven rather than issue driven. And I tried to make a comparison between the Republican debates thus far, the Republican campaign for the nomination, and the Democratic campaign. And I realize that Hillary Clinton is way out in front of Bernie Sanders, but on the other hand, Bernie Sanders is making quite a show. He's doing a fabulous job, and he has closed the gap at least somewhat. He's raising significant money. I noticed in yesterday's media that Bernie Sanders' campaign had raised about $33 million to close out the year of 2015 at the very end. So it's clear that there are a lot of people that are supporting Bernie, and as he points out numerous times, most of his campaigns are on the smaller side. He is not taking PAC money. He has no big suitors or patrons or those that are giving him big money. Therefore, they are not controlling him. His campaign is independent. But if you think about the debates of the two sides thus far, as they've been broadcast on television, it's pretty clear that the Republican debates have focused on issues, whereas the Democratic debates have focused on issues, whereas the Republican debates have largely been personality focused. To a degree, I realize that there are issues that are in the Republican debates as well. The idea of a wall, the idea of keeping Muslims out of the country, and many of the other positions that Donald Trump has taken. But the fact of the matter is, it's a little bit difficult for Republican challengers to Donald Trump to make a case, to pin their candidacy on the issues, when the personality of Donald Trump is literally overwhelming the campaign. So, and that was the point that I made yesterday. And so with that, I'd like to at least refer you to the second hour of yesterday's program in order to touch base as a lead in to what I'd like to introduce for today's program. You'll recall that in our second hour yesterday, we dealt specifically with the New Year's revolutions, not resolutions, but revolutions of one Parker Palmer. And I spent quite a bit of time yesterday talking about Parker Palmer and the number of books he's written. The one I mentioned, of course, relates to teaching. And it is the courage, it's entitled The Courage to Teach. And basically he talks about what a real teaching environment in a real learning situation would involve on the part of the teacher. There is not only an intellectual investment in classroom teaching, he points out. There is an emotional, a psychic investment as well. One must put their heart into the classroom and into the teaching and learning of students. And so therefore, he feels that there's quite a bit of personal courage involved if you're really going to do a good job in the classroom. And he has written a number of books and a number of essays on the issues of teaching and the value of good teaching. And the point that of yesterday's second hour of our program was the fact that, for New Year's in the New York Times, he wrote about five so-called revolutions that needed to happen in 2016 in order that Americans could, in his words, recover their humanity. And the implication is that the areas that he addressed, which were inequality, racism, the issue of keeping Muslims out of the country, the issue of otherness, the inclination or the tendency to distrust all of those who are or look different than we are, and rather than welcoming these people as we have traditionally done, his concern is that the nation seems to have moved into a perspective which is very, very suspicious. And of course, it's all linked to the issues of terrorism. And he points out, of course, that the presence of Donald Trump in the campaign and the fear factor that seems to be dominating the campaign in the areas of terrorism has produced very logical, very predictable conclusions, and he's very concerned about that. And he believes having a very negative impact on the general public. And so his revolutions were proactive ways that we in 2016 could begin to take on many of these issues and reassert and reestablish our principles, our truths, our values, as they pertain particularly to these issues of inequality, the issues of bigotry and racism and many of the other things that exist in our society. There's absolutely no question, and this we finished the program yesterday, by just getting in the five, we spent the full hour on the five so-called revolutions that Parker Palmer addresses, and we didn't really get a chance to reach any final conclusions or any closing comments on the article. So I thought that's where we ought to go today, and then I wanted to present something that is, as you'll see, quite a contrast to that. It seems to me that if one were to summarize or pull together the key ingredients of Parker Palmer's presentation in the New Year's edition of the New York Times, one could conclude, and I think with reason, that his agenda for proactive action in each of these areas suggests an agenda of that is clearly progressive. It is clearly liberal. Obviously, Parker Palmer's writing and thinking is going to appeal to people who are on the side of progressivism and liberalism. They are not going to stress some of the negatives. They're going to stress positives. The presentation, obviously, while it's dealing with very serious issues, is structured in such a way that his intent was to provide for the reader very positive actions, positive things that we could do in order to turn around some of our positions and some of our issues on those, in those areas, as he says, in order to recover our humanity. So the implication here is that many of these issues and the directions they have taken are, in a sense, at the cost of what he believes is our humanity. And so his overall objective in this piece is to suggest strategies to recover a portion of that humanity. It's a very progressive, action-first agenda. And the reason I wanted to present that is because it seems to me that it's a game plan of action for liberals and progressives who might be inclined to throw up their hands and say that there's really nothing we can do in any of these areas. And I think his whole intent was to suggest, yes, indeed, there are things we can do as individuals in our own little portion of the world. And that's really his theme. I say this because today I would like to contrast it with a more conservative, right-of-center perspective, not so much on the new year in the area of revolutions or resolutions per se. But I'd like to share with you a piece that in my reading over the weekend I came across. And I think the title of this particular piece, the author is John Hawkins. It's dated January 2nd, 2016, which was, as you know, Saturday. And the title of the piece is 15 Stats That Destroy Liberal Narratives. Let me repeat that title. 15 Stats, Statistics, That Destroy Liberal Narratives. His thesis, then, is that each of these 15 items presents data which pretty well undercuts or shoots down liberal positions on some of our most significant issues in today's world. So it stands to reason, then, that this presentation by John Hawkins is going to be directly opposed or contrasted with the five positive revolutions that we looked at from Parker Palmer on yesterday. This is an effort to present data which pretty much refutes at least this is the basis of the author, pretty much refutes liberal positions on many issues and many things that we focus on in today's society. Each of the 15 items is in the context of a quotation from a particular individual, a particular person. A couple of these, for example, I'll tell you ahead of time, are statements attributed to Ann Coulter, for example. And many of you are very aware of the name Ann Coulter. She's a spokesman, has been a very popular spokesman, has appeared on a number of programs and daises around the country, spouting conservative causes and conservative positions on issues. She appears regularly on Fox, as well as a number of others. Let me run through, because you may be familiar with many of these names when I'm not. One of the names associated with these 15 items, Mark Krikorian, is one. Greg Jones is another. Scott Atlas is yet another. Avik Roy, A-V-I-K, Avik Roy, R-O-Y. Jonah Goldberg, and I know that Jonah Goldberg is a regular writer in the National Review. He's a prominent conservative author and speaker. He wrote a book a number of years ago, Conservative Bill of Rights. He's written positions on ways that conservatives can muscle their way onto college campuses and into the discussions on what he believes are our campuses controlled predominantly by liberals. Other names on this list, Ann Coulter, as I mentioned, Ross Douthat, who is an author and writes a regular column twice a week in the New York Times. He is one of the more conservative writers on the staff, on the comment staff of the New York Times, Ross Douthat. Another citation or quote from Mark Krikorian. Another name on this list is Jason Riley. Yet another, Heather McDonald. Oliver Darcy. Mark Fulman. Yet again, another by Ann Coulter. Mark Hodges. Anyway, those are the names associated with these particular quotations. So what this article is then is a compilation of 15 items or 15 quotations by prominent conservative spokesmen whose research has produced data which the author believes, depending on the particular topic that the quotation is about, pretty well refutes liberal positions on those issues. As a contrast, even though I know that the fairness doctrine is not active anymore, but as part of my effort to be fair, I would like to contrast the Parker Palmer presentation yesterday with these 15 items, because I do want to comment on, and you know, I don't know that I can add a whole lot to many of these, but I can sure try. And again, we have a phone number. Our phone number, again, is area code 304-663-4676. I invite you, as I go through these items on today's program, to feel free to pick up the phone and make a comment. If you have a particular comment on the issue at hand, we would love to hear from you. I do not claim to be able to deal substantively with all of these. I believe that I can offer some insight and some thoughts on many of them. But I think it pretty well serves, and let me point this out. When you look at these 15 items, once we complete them, we will have looked at some of the major conservative positions on contemporary issues on today's conservative agenda. These are the major issues and the major items that conservatives believe are issues that liberals tend to promote, tend to feature or focus upon, And these statements come up with data, research data, which the author believes pretty much refutes liberal positions on these issues. So again, what I would like to say as a, you know, as a prelude to the details here, is that when you look at the 15 items together in toto, it becomes a pretty good smorgasbord or accounting of some of the major issues and major positions that bother conservatives, that conservatives feel the need to worry about. In other words, the mere fact that they are on this list or in this article, the mere fact that the research data has been compiled suggests that these are issues which conservatives feel the need to respond to. That in itself, I would argue, is very informative. It should help us all. It should basically then serve to inform all of us on the ingredients of a conservative agenda in today's world. And ironically, given the nature of the presidential campaign thus far, and given the fact that the Republican side of the agenda has pretty much focused more on personalities than on issues, it seems more than beneficial that we look at this list, because the issues are here. These are some of the issues that perhaps Republican debaters would be focusing on if it weren't for the fact that there are 12 to 14 candidates on the stage in most of the Republican debates. So with that, let me begin. The first item comes from Mark Krikorian, and this is the quotation. Muslims account for only about 1% of the U.S. population, but account for about half of terrorist attacks since 9/11. That means Muslims in the United States are about 5,000% more likely to commit terrorist attacks than non-Muslims, unquote. So that's the position, that the majority of terrorist attacks that this nation has experienced since 9/11 have been committed by Muslims. And so therefore, even though Muslims comprise but 1% of our population, and yet they are committing the bulk of the terrorism that exists in our country, then Mark Krikorian's conclusion is that that means that Muslims are about 5,000 times more likely to commit terrorist attacks than non-Muslims. To Mark Krikorian, that data is supposed to answer liberal positions on terrorism, or liberal arguments on terrorism. In other words, that's supposed to be the data that is irrefutable. In other words, that's supposed to be the citation and the data that can't be refuted. The fact of the matter is, if you look at that quotation, it seems to me there's quite a bit there that one can comment on. For example, I think the first thing to consider as you consider that data is the way we define terrorism. I would suggest to you that if you define terrorism in conjunction with many of the attacks that Muslims have indeed been responsible for in this country, then by definition, the way you define terrorism pretty much is going to support this data. I would suggest to you, however, that there are many, myself included, who raise serious questions about the way we define terrorism. I would suggest to you, as an example, that the two shooters in San Bernardino a couple of weeks ago were terrorists. That was a terrorist attack. And I would suggest probably as strong a reason for the fact that it is defined as a terrorist attack is because it was carried out by two Muslims, who in this case happened to be husband and wife. But the fact that it was carried out by Muslims make it terrorism. On the other hand, the shooting of Tamir Rice, a 12-year-old in Cleveland, by the Cleveland police, is not terrorism. And I guess what I'm saying is, it depends on the way you define these particular issues. It seems to me when an act is committed by a Muslim, it falls into the category of terrorism. When it's committed by whites, it doesn't fall into that category, whether in fact it's terrorism or not. So it seems to me the way we define terms here pretty much determines this particular data. So I would suggest to you, and I'm not trying to paint over or to put a positive spin on very negative information, negative events. There's no question that the debates that are going on and Donald Trump's position on barring Muslims from the United States, as he says, until we figure out what the hell's going on, when in fact we know darn well what's going on. We know that there's a very strong position on the right in this country. The right in this country is very, very committed to the idea of going to war with international extremist Muslims, Islam. The president's concern is that to do so would make it appear that we were at war with Islam, with billions of Muslims. And the president's position is all Muslims are not terrorists, but this data suggests indeed they are. The implication of this data suggests that terrorism and Islam go hand in hand. If you accept this data without question, then you have no option, no alternative, other than to conclude that we are at war with Islam throughout the world. If that's true, then we're in serious, serious problems, even more than we think we are. We have decided that to be a Muslim is to be a terrorist or a prospective terrorist. Once we conclude that, we are suggesting that it's the religion rather than the individuals involved who are responsible. It seems to me that in none of our gun-related attacks or explosions on planes or whatever, in none of these do we say that the particular crime or the particular attack was perpetrated by Christians or Jews. But we're more than inclined to report it when it is committed by Muslims. It seems to me to suggest this data, the very collection of this data and the way it is presented, seems to me to say more about the agenda of the author than it does about the validity of the data itself. It's how you read it, how carefully you read it, and how carefully you look at the implications of the data. If you take this data as 100% factual and not in any way slanted, not in any way related to any kind of a political agenda, then it seems to me you are left with some pretty dire conclusions about the future of the world. There's no question that there are many people in this nation, most of them on the right, who want to incite this kind of action. They are trying to move the agenda into this particular anti-Muslim framework. They are referring to it as a war between civilizations. They are suggesting that there is a world war going on between the Christians of the world and the Muslims of the world. The fact of the matter is, the more they debate it, the more they talk about it, the more they assert it, the more they present data like this, the more they are exacerbating and causing the very problem that they are writing about. By continuing to assert this kind of data and the logical conclusions to be drawn from it, they cease to be commentators on world events, and they become actors in the process. They become directly involved. They are inciting and instigating the very situation that their data speaks to. In other words, we find that they end up in very self-serving presentations of data. The data tends to fit very well into their own personal political agendas. And we need to recognize it as such, and we need to deal with the quotation as such. I would suggest to you that this data, I'm going back to the title, which supposedly destroys liberal narratives, in fact raises more comments than it answers. It is, as presented, an example of a problem, not a factual, non-political effort to explain the depth and seriousness of a problem. This collection of data as presented here is a political act. It instigates terrorism. It helps to initiate the very thing that the nation is most worried about. We need to recognize it for what it is, it seems to me, and we need to deal with it accordingly. That's number one of 15. And here we are with about 45 minutes left in our program. So clearly this particular list, if we indeed follow it all the way through, is going to go well beyond today's program and into tomorrow's program as well. But so be it, because I think each of these issues is very significant and worthy of attention. Let me deal with issue number two, statistical data on item number two. Quote, this is all information presented by Greg Jones. Quote, consider, for example, that in 1958, a mere 4% of Americans approved of interracial marriage. By 2013, that number had grown to 87%. In 2012, these once taboo unions hit an all-time high. So the issue in item number two is interracial marriage. The data suggests that as recently as 1958, 4% of Americans, according to survey data, approved of interracial marriage. In 2013, that 4% had grown to 87%. So by this time recently then, interracial marriage has become a generally acceptable situation or status in our society. Most Americans, 87% of them, accept it. Now, again, it seems to me we need to raise issues about the word approved of interracial marriage. What does it mean to approve it? It doesn't necessarily mean to advocate it. It might only mean to basically say it's their right. Whatever, you know, they're free people. What they choose to do, they have a right to do in this nation. For me to question their right to marry is an interference with their freedom to do what they think they need to do as prospective partners in an interracial relationship. So approve is kind of a loaded word. Approve might be to recognize people's right to do it and conclude that it's none of my business. There's quite a difference between that and actively advocating interracial partnerships. The word approve could be interpreted to mean something much more than it might actually mean. But let's go on. So the first item here is the increase in the percentage of people who approved of interracial marriage. 4% in 1958, 87% in 2013. Next paragraph. Ku Klux Klan membership has shrunk drastically from millions a century ago to fewer than 5,000 today. Ku Klux Klan membership has shrunk drastically from millions 100 years ago to fewer than 5,000 today. I don't think any of us would question that. The Black Panthers are essentially extinct. While plenty of other hate groups have attempted to fill the void, they have always operated on the margins of society. Black politicians are now common. President Obama's percentage of the white vote was almost perfectly in line with that received by other recent Democratic candidates, all of whom were white. So that's the data. The percentage of people who approve, in quotation marks, of interracial marriage has increased from 4% in 1958 to 87% in 2013. Ku Klux Klan membership from a century ago has declined from millions to a mere 5,000 today. Black Panther membership has pretty much disappeared. The Black Panther movement, which was so prominent in the 60s, has pretty well become extinct. Black politicians are everywhere. So most of us don't react anymore to the fact that a particular candidate for political office is African American. People used to respond to that. They don't anymore. And, of course, the most obvious example of that is Barack Obama himself. And the fact that President Obama's percentage of white votes was pretty much in line with what recent Democratic candidates have been receiving. And they were all white candidates. So that's the data. Here's the conclusion. Granted, these statistics offer but a snapshot of American society. But the more one looks, the more a trend emerges. America is a lot of things. Racist isn't one of them, unquote, says Greg Jones. In other words, this data is being used to justify the conclusion that concerns about racism in today's society are unfounded. I would suggest, and obviously the issue of racism is a major issue on the progressive liberal agenda. The mere fact that this is the second issue in a list of 15 under consideration suggest that for conservatives eager to refute liberal positions on some of the most prominent issues, this to them is a major one, namely to refute or deny the realities of racism in today's American society. True or false? It seems to me that there is a lot of other data that could be pulled together to refute this data. The fact that the Black Panthers have disappeared, the fact that Ku Klux Klan membership has declined precipitously in the last 100 years, the fact that more and more Americans are willing to accept the existence of interracial marriage does not deny the realities of racism. It indicates in a number of areas that improvements have been made. It does not indicate that the nation has ceased to be racist. I don't exactly know. I mean, there are a number of different directions that we can go in with this, but I would question that conclusion by Greg Jones. It seems to me that there's too much in society which suggests that racism continues to exist. The situation of white, predominantly white police departments killing adult male blacks is significant in our society. The issue of racial profiling is real in our society. I mentioned earlier at the beginning of our program today that I shared breakfast with a close friend this morning. And one of the things that he was sharing with me was a particular situation that emerged years ago when he was an employee for a private corporation. In fact, it was digital. Digital Electronics Corporation, DEC, if you remember. It was a very prominent corporation in America in the late 20th century. And he was pointing out training. And the issue was diversity training. The focus was gender more than race. But he shared with me a story from his memory about this particular training. And it dealt with a woman, a white woman, in the group. And he talked about how passionate she was. And her point, and this was the way he explained it, her point to the rest of the people in this training session was as follows. Until you can relate to the situation of a female leaving a department store at night in the dark and walking to her car across a poorly lit parking lot, and can relate to the fear that a woman would have until she's safely in her car and the doors are locked and the engine starts. Her point was, until you can relate to that situation, you can't really know what being a woman in today's contemporary society means. And the reason I mention that is because it seems to me to point to the same situation as we're talking about here relative to the issue of racism. To deny that racism exists in America is to deny the obvious. It's to deny the testimony of Black Americans who talk about and share stories about being profiled in their automobiles, about being profiled in particular social settings and social situations. It seems to me that racism in this country has been, in recent years, so universally and uniformly criticized that membership in groups like the Ku Klux Klan and the rest of it would naturally decline, because to belong to these organizations is to announce and promote the idea that you are indeed a racist. In our society, nobody's going to do that. But the mere fact that people have chosen not to do that by joining organizations like the Ku Klux Klan or not joining organizations like the Black Panthers does not in any way deny the realities of racism. It just suggests that the situation has become much more devious, much more difficult to define. But at the same time, to deny that it even exists, it seems to me, denies the testimony of Black Americans all over the place. It denies the reality of situations in Ferguson, Missouri, and in Baltimore, and in many of other American cities. It denies the anger and the hostility that exists in many of our cities that we've seen on television night after night after night. And again, it's too easy to attribute these situations to, quote, thugs, and to deny the fact that it speaks to issues related to racism in our society. But the fact of the matter is, I would argue there's nothing in this data to prove to me that racism as a problem in America has been solved. I would suggest to you that it has not been. I would also suggest that it's one of the issues we better get about trying to solve. We need to continue. People not joining the Ku Klux Klan is not a solution to the problem. It's a start, but it clearly is not a solution to the problem. So the first item dealt with Muslims being the perpetrators of most of the terrorism in America since 9/11. The second one deals with racism and suggests that America may be a lot of things, but racist isn't one of them. What in Lord's name would be the third item on this list? This particular item material is attributed to Scott Atlas, and I do not have any idea who Scott Atlas might be, although I can begin to guess from the presentation itself. So let me look and share with you item number three. Quote, the harsh reality awaiting these low-income Americans is undeniable. According to 2013 data from a 2014 Merritt Hawkins study, 55% of doctors already refuse new Medicaid patients. According to the HSC Health Tracking Physician Survey 2008, the percentage of doctors that refuse new Medicaid patients dwarfed by about 8 to 10 times the percentage that refuses new private insurance patients, unquote. So what is the data speaking to? It's speaking to the expansion of Medicaid for poor poverty level Americans in our society. It speaks to the fact that 55% of doctors refuse to accept new Medicaid patients, which is 8 to 10 times larger than those doctors who are willing to accept new private insurance patients. Doctors, in other words, the conclusion of this particular material suggests doctors are more than willing to serve those with private insurance. They are unwilling to provide medical services to Medicaid patients. At least 55% of them are, according to a 2014 survey. This goes on as follows. Such insurance, in quotations, from Obamacare, here's item number three, Obamacare, not only fails to provide access to doctors, but research in the top medical journals such as Cancer, American Journal of Cardiology, Journal of Heart and Lung Transplantation, and Annals of Surgery shows that Medicaid beneficiaries suffer worse outcomes than similar patients with private insurance, all at an added cost of another $800 billion by CBO estimates to taxpayers after the decade. So the second paragraph in this particular item focuses on Obamacare, on Affordable Care Act. And it suggests that major medical journals are showing that those patients who are on Medicaid have worse outcomes than patients with private insurance. The implication being that doctors, therefore, are less inclined to serve them, and that instead, the taxpayers are being saddled with an $800 billion bill to provide medical care, health care, to Medicaid recipients. Here's the final paragraph, or the conclusion. It is not hyperbole to call Medicaid a disgrace at its annual cost of about $450 billion. And expanding it rather than helping poor people buy private insurance is simply inexplicable. Item number three by Scott Atlas is an attack on the Affordable Care Act. We know that eliminating Obamacare, so-called, is a priority item on the conservative hit list. It has been since the act went into effect. It has been since the act has continued to enroll more and more people, millions of them, and it continues to be an item. The implication is that medical care to poor people who are on Medicaid is a waste of money. It's a waste of taxpayers' money. And the way you prove that is you contrast it with the outcomes of patients who are on regular private insurance. Obviously, the message here that Scott Atlas wants the reader to deduce or conclude from this data is that Obamacare and indeed Medicare need to be challenged, need to be eliminated, need to be changed. And as he says in the final paragraph, rather than expand Medicaid, which already costs about $450 billion a year, it would be better to try to help poor people by finding ways that they can buy private insurance. The implication is the Affordable Care Act is so wrong, so ineffective, that it needs to be abolished. That's the data. So obviously, the thinking of the author of this particular piece, John Hawkins, is that this data ought to convince people that Obamacare needs to be eliminated and that we need to do something about Medicare in order to get control over the costs and find ways to provide private insurance to poor people. Where to begin? I think the first thing that I would offer here is a little bit of history on the Affordable Care Act itself. Many people in this country, at the time Obamacare was first initiated, and I'm using that term Obamacare because everybody knows what it is. It's kind of a negative term, obviously. It's the Affordable Care Act. And to associate it with President Obama is part of the effort to demean it, and we know that. The fact of the matter is many people on the progressive side, on the left side of the ledger, were in favor of single-payer health insurance, universal health care. No private insurance involved at all. In other words, the model would be Medicare. And Bernie Sanders right now is running for president, and his position on this issue is that we need to expand Medicare to take on not just senior citizens, but all citizens. We need to use Medicare as the model. People ought to be able to go to the doctor, receive the medical attention that they need, and be able to send the bill to government, as many other developed nations throughout the world are doing, rather than charging people for the particular ailment or the particular injury or disease that afflicts them. If that's true, how do we explain the Affordable Care Act? There's no question that President Obama's inclination, decision, determination, whatever you want to call it, to work with conservatives once he was elected, suggested that while he wanted to do something about health care for poor people in this country that didn't have it, his solution, which was the Affordable Care Act, incorporated or included private insurance companies. Obviously, President Obama wanted to find a way to work toward a solution on health care with conservatives by incorporating private insurance into the operation. The goal of the Affordable Care Act is to make health insurance, not health care, health insurance available to as many Americans as possible. In other words, it was a way to expand health care without at the same time doing damage to the private sector, to the profit motive, to free enterprise. It ended up being a bonanza for many insurance companies. It clearly ended up to become a benefit for hospitals, because the result has been that hospitals have seen the numbers of people who walk into their emergency rooms for treatment, those who have no insurance, no way to pay, those numbers have declined incredibly rapidly, precipitously. There was an article in the local Gazette, in the Charleston Gazette this past weekend here in West Virginia, which indicated that hospitals in West Virginia alone have seen a $265 million profit from the fact that since Obamacare went into effect, they are no longer treating people without insurance who walk in off the street. More likely it is that those who come to hospitals for medical services have insurance as a result of the Affordable Care Act. That means that the hospitals are getting paid something. They're obviously not getting paid for the cost of services dollar for dollar. They're getting reimbursed at a much lower rate than the cost of the services, but they are getting reimbursed, which was something that didn't exist before the Affordable Care Act. So the fact of the matter is, the goals of the Affordable Care Act have in large part not been realized completely, but have been realized to a substantial degree, because more and more people who didn't have insurance before are able to get it now. But the fact of the matter is the costs of that insurance are increasing, and we know that. And critics of the Affordable Care Act are using the increase in insurance premiums to demean the program. The fact of the matter is that several states have refused to expand their Medicaid rolls in order to bring health care to people that didn't have it. In other words, by not doing that, states predominantly headed by Republicans have refused to participate in the Affordable Care Act, have refused to expand and extend medical insurance, health insurance, to their own citizens. In the process, have turned down tens of millions of dollars in federal reimbursements because of their ideological opposition to the Affordable Care Act. So the fact of the matter is, part of the problem that the Affordable Care Act has had, which is indeed helping to increase the costs, is the fact that conservatives themselves have done everything that they can do to sabotage the program, to deny applicability of the program to significant numbers of their own citizens in their own states. And now for these people to do that and then turn around and accuse the program of not being able to deliver on what it promised seems to me the most hypocritical thing that one could possibly imagine. I would predict, and I know this is difficult given the fact that Republicans control both houses of Congress, the House of Representatives as well as the Senate at the federal level, I would predict that the more successful the attack on the Affordable Care Act becomes, the more likely is going to become a groundswell movement for universal health care. I think in the long term, the defeat of the Affordable Care Act will produce universal health care in this country, which I believe is the best outcome of all. I think that that's probably one of the major errors that President Obama made. He believed that he could work with and cooperate with his political opponents in order to reach a solution on health care. To do that, he included private insurance companies as key players in the Affordable Care Act in order to incorporate and preserve the free enterprise system as opposed to universal health care, which many believe is socialistic, many terms socialism. And in order to avoid that, he went the extra mile for the private sector, for the pre-enterprise system, and for people representing that sector to attack him, it seems to me, is the height of hypocrisy and political insincerity. So I believe that this item number three, the criticism of so-called Obamacare by the medical community. And let's deal with the first issue, the fact that 55% of doctors surveyed refused to accept new Medicaid patients. Question. Is that the responsibility or the fault of the Affordable Care Act? Or does that speak to the particular doctors involved who refused to do it? I wrote an article to the newspaper some time back, and it's probably 2 years ago, about the issues of health care and the concerns about the escalating rise in healthcare costs in America. My point was that it's impossible to get a handle on the costs of healthcare because it's impossible to know accurately what they are. Let me explain why. We know, if we will but look, because it's everywhere, the evidence is everywhere, that doctors and hospitals and clinics and laboratories are passing on the costs of services to the poor who can't pay by overcharging those with private insurance who can pay. In other words, those with private insurance, those who can afford private insurance, are subsidizing services delivered to those who can't afford it. That, I would suggest to you, is socialism. The difference is that government is not doing that. The private sector is doing it. Hospitals are doing it. Medical clinics are doing it. Laboratories are doing it. The argument then is that if people had to pay dollar for dollar on the medical services they receive, that would be the only way that we could get a handle on what the true costs of medical health care really are in this country. But we can't do it because the costs are inflated in order to cover services delivered to those who cannot pay. Therefore, there's no way to get a handle on health care costs because there's no way to determine accurately what they are. It's a mess. Why don't we do it then? Why don't we just universally stop delivering services to anyone who cannot pay for them? I would suggest to you the reason that we're not doing that is because that would reveal just how inequitable the delivery of health services in this country really is. The reason that there hasn't been a revolution over the costs of health care so far is because, to a large degree, services are being provided to the indigent, to the very poor who can't pay. Walk-ins at hospitals continue to be served. Hospitals are forbidden to refuse emergency services to the sick, irrespective of whether they can pay or not. We realize, of course, that hospitals turn around and discharge these people who cannot pay as quickly as they possibly can, and they wash their hands on the whole situation, but they do provide the emergency services. Somebody has to pay for those. And currently, those paying for them are those with private insurance. So the fact of the matter is the whole process is blurred and bogus. There's no way to accurately measure the costs of the real costs of healthcare in this country because these costs are artificially inflated. Different hospitals charge different rates for the same thing. We know that. It's the proverbial price war in the area of gasoline prices per gallon on steroids. We know that services like mammograms, for example, can vary by hundreds and hundreds, even thousands of dollars, depending on where you get the mammogram. So in a sense, all the costs for medical services are bogus. None of them are really valid. All of them are inflated. And so therefore, we are living in a dream. It seems to me that universal health care is ultimately the only way to go. But in the interim, we've got the Affordable Care Act. To attack it and criticize it because it is not successful, it's not reaching its objectives, when so many Republican-controlled states have consciously refused to participate in the program in their efforts to kill it, seems to me to be the height of hypocrisy. And so I think that's what I would contribute or offer on item number 3. It looks like we might have time for one more because it's now 10 minutes to the hour. So we've got about 8 minutes left in our program today. Let's look at number 4. Again, this deals with Obamacare. Conclusion, the Affordable Care Act is a major item on the conservative agenda. This, more than any other, is the item that conservatives most want to challenge. I think that tells us a lot. How many times has Republican-controlled House of Representatives taken a vote to defund Obamacare? 45, 50, 55 times? Waste of time, waste of money. But we continue to see it happen. Here's item number four. Quote, in other words, all of the disruption, spending, taxation, and premium hikes in Obamacare has only reduced the percentage of U.S. residents without health insurance by 2.7 percentage points, from 13.9% to 11.1%, a remarkably small reduction, far lower than what the law was supposed to achieve. The author of that presentation of that data, Avik Roy. So in other words, in spite of all of the taxation and all the hype and all the discussion and all the political ins and outs associated with the Affordable Care Act, Roy's data shows that the percentage of people without health insurance has only declined 2.7 percentage points, from 13.9% to 11.1%. A rather meager outcome, given the splash and the political firestorm that the Affordable Care Act has created, two Supreme Court cases and all the rest of it. So the conclusion of this particular data is that despite all the hype and all the argument, the impact on the number of people who have been able to get health insurance has only been 2.7% more than it was before. It seems to me that the comments that I would make on this particular data apply to the previous item as well. Look at the number of states that have refused to expand their Medicaid rolls in order to make people eligible for health care. In other words, they have exploded the costs of Medicaid because they have refused to allow Medicaid patients or those eligible for Medicaid in their own states access to health insurance under the Affordable Care Act. In other words, by denying them health insurance under the Affordable Care Act, they have naturally forced them to rely only on the Medicaid rolls. But by refusing to expand those rolls, these state governments are denying medical services to their own citizens, and they're getting away with it in the 21st century. It is an unmitigated disgrace. I would suggest to you, in today's world, I see the rhetoric all the time, but it is my feeling, and I'm going to say it, that in today's world, and given the costs associated with medical services, with health care is not a privilege that only those who can pay for should have access to. Health care is a right, is a human right in today's world. To expect people to go without health care when the ability to treat diseases and injuries, serious injuries, is available but only to the people who can pay for it, to deny these services to others is an inhuman disgrace. It speaks to the loss of humanity that Parker Palmer mentioned in his piece. And it seems to me that for critics of the Affordable Care Act to do everything they can do to attack, defund, and ultimately destroy the Affordable Care Act, and then to turn around and criticize it because it has only increased the number of people with health insurance by 2.7%. I can't think of any other way to say it, is the epitome, the height of hypocrisy. It is absolutely absurd. But these folks continue to do it. That's four items of the 15. And we have 5 minutes left in today's program. So let's look at item number five, and maybe we can at least get the item covered. And what we can do is open tomorrow's program by returning to item number five and just quickly review the first four tomorrow, and then we'll take up the rest of these in tomorrow's program. Item number five, quote, Bernie Sanders thinks you can pay for an $18 trillion expansion of the welfare state to make it align with a Denmark that doesn't actually exist, simply by taxing the billionaire class. There are 536 billionaires in America. Even if you confiscated everything they had, which, by the way, would surely destroy the American economy by triggering the greatest round of capital flight in human history and amount to government seizure of countless businesses, it wouldn't come close to covering the tab of Sanders' proposals, unquote. Author Jonah Goldberg, the author that I mentioned before that writes regularly for the National Review and has written a number of books on conservative Bill of Rights and other things. So the criticism here is of Bernie Sanders' campaign to tax billionaires to pay for an $18 trillion expansion of the welfare state. That's not what Bernie Sanders is talking about. He is talking about adequately taxing people in this country by eliminating the loopholes, taxing people according to what they pay, which is the definition of progressive taxation, and using that revenue to fund infrastructure improvements in this country and to create what he says 13 million well-paying jobs with health care and fringe benefits. Obviously, in spite of the thrust of this quote by Jonah Goldberg, Bernie Sanders is not anticipating that 536 people are going to be able to pay for this. So in other words, what's happening is that his ideas are being taken out of context, are being taken to the extreme in order to argue that they are absurd. What Bernie Sanders is talking about is making those people who currently are able to escape our progressive tax system through loopholes, eliminating those loopholes and making people pay their fair share. If that happens, 13 million good-paying jobs will be created. And if 13 million good-paying jobs are created, that's going to mean that those people who hold those jobs, 13 million people, will be paying taxes and will be contributing to the funds necessary to fund infrastructure repair and replacement in our society, not just the 536 billionaires in this country. So this is taking Bernie Sanders' proposal out of context, expanding it to an absurd degree, and then ridiculing it. It is a disgrace. Jonah Goldberg is brighter than that. Jonah Goldberg knows better. This is a disgrace. It's dishonest. It's disgraceful. And it shouldn't be allowed to continue. We are not able to continue any longer either, because it is now 59 minutes after the hour. I want to thank you for tuning in to today's edition of the Virtual Center. I want to invite you back to tomorrow. I hope that you'll think about the issues that we've already covered and avail yourself of the opportunities available to you to make comments and add things to these particular issues. This is Bill O'Brien. Thank you so much for your time and for your attention. I hope that you'll be safe and that you'll be kind to each other. We'll be back together again tomorrow here at the Virtual Center. Thank you.